Color is one of the most important development choices you will make for your game.
However, the science of color is highly complex and well beyond the scope of any one workshop.
In this creator classroom, we discuss the basics of color theory, going over palettes, schemes, and the psychology of color choice to aid you in designing the visuals of your game.
Get ready to learn why color truly matters, because class is in session. Hello everyone, I'm Steel.
And I'm Teal.
And we're with Studio Blue.
Welcome to our Creator Classroom. Tonight's topic is Color Theory Basics.
So this is one we've talked about for a while now, and it is going to be technical because it is the science of color. However, for the sake of ours and your sanity, we're only going to go over a primer. It's a very detailed subject. When you say so, honey.
In entire books, entire courses are taught on color theory. Tonight's classroom is simply doing a basic overview of it. It is by no means a deep dive. If you would like a deeper dive into it, there are courses online, Udemy and others, that could certainly help you explore it in more detail. We're just doing what we call a survey course, which is just a look at it, a basic look.
Right, and we're giving you this heads up ahead of time, simply because if you're coming in thinking that a deep dive is even possible within 2 to 3 hours, no, as Teal said, that's not the case. So we want you to know what you're getting into. Yeah. And by the way, if you're watching this live, please give us a follow and consider subscribing. And if you're watching this on VOD on YouTube, please give us a like, a subscribe, comment in the comment section. It really helps out. And hey, spread the word. Let's get the color theory basics out to the game dev community. Teal?
Okay.
It's all on you, man. Take it away, man.
Let's get started. So, what is color theory? Sir Isaac Newton established color theory when he invented the color wheel in 1666.
So it's been around for a while.
Yes, it has. Several centuries, in fact. Color theory is both the science and art of using color. Mm. It explains how humans perceive color and the visual effects of how colors mix, match, or contrast with each other. Color theory also involves the messages that colors communicate, as well as the methods used to replicate colors.
Right.
This is a very basic definition of color theory.
When Sir Isaac Newton put this together, there really hadn't been, prior to it, a science behind what was previously seen just as an art form.
Correct.
Sir Isaac Newton, whose innumerable contributions to the scientific community allowed him to analyze how color actually affects certain parts of the brain psychologically,
right,
as well as how people perceive it.
Yes.
Hey, thank you so much for the subscription, Damian. Subscribed for 6 months. Oh my god.
That
six
is incredible. Happy 6 month anniversary. All right, let us move on.
Yes, he's just chatting. He says some wonderful happy things. Yay, color theory. Yes, this is just so you know, this is not going to be the most exciting topic. This is a science dive. So, yeah, as I was saying before our awesome Damian resubscribed, Sir Isaac Newton looked at it from a scientist's perspective, and the idea of color theory has never been the same since then. Go ahead, Teal.
In fact, the art world has greatly benefited from Sir Newton's research.
Yes.
And his findings.
Yes, and you as game developers will especially, once you really understand how color theory works, you yourself will benefit.
So, the color wheel. Newton understood colors as human perceptions, not absolute qualities of wavelengths of light. By systematically categorizing colors, he defined three groups. The primary colors of red, yellow, and blue. The secondary colors. These are mixes of the primary colors mm-hmm. that give us green, orange, and purple.
Mm-hmm.
And then the tertiary colors. These are mixes of the primary and secondary colors. It gives us yellow-orange, red-orange, red-purple, blue-purple, blue-green, and yellow-green.
Now, a question if I may, Teal.
Yes.
It says on the color wheel, violet, yet you refer to it as purple. Is there a reason that we will address later, or is that just some people like to call it violet, others like to call it purple? Am I jumping the gun?
No, you're not. That's a very good question. There's a difference between purple and violet.
Okay.
Violet is the name of the particular wavelength that falls in that spectrum.
Ah.
It is a light wave color.
Okay.
Purple is the human perception of the light wave of violet.
Right. Because if I recall from Science 101, humans can't actually see the color violet.
No, we can't.
What we
perceive as violet is actually the mix of blue light and red light.
Got it, because violet, otherwise known as ultraviolet, is on the higher end of the spectrum from what the human eye can perceive. And indeed, Teal, would you not say that all of this really does deal with light waves?
It does indeed. This is based on light waves and the human perception of light waves.
Right, because humans see a very limited spectrum of color. We don't see most of what light actually is. The visible spectrum is very small. We're not going to go too deep into the science of that.
That's a very deep dive.
But in a brief, broad stroke, light has a certain frequency, and we only see a very small range of that frequency, which is what we refer to as the visible spectrum.
Right.
Everything outside of that is invisible, and the color violet just happens to be actually
outside.
It's
on the edge of our perception.
There you go.
So that's why we will see purple.
Right. Fantastic.
Okay. You'll notice that you can draw a line through the center of this wheel.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll be separating the warm colors, which are the reds, oranges, and yellows,
uh-huh.
from the cool colors, which are the blues, greens, and purples.
I see.
I'll go over color temperature a little later on in the presentation.
Which is a very important thing in a game, not just for texturing, but lighting as well. Very interesting.
We have two basic color mixing models that we all typically work with.
Right.
Any color you see on a physical surface, such as paper or signage or packaging, uses the subtractive color mixing model.
Mm-hmm.
Subtractive simply refers to the fact that you subtract the light from the paper by adding more color.
Ah.
Traditionally, the primary colors used in the subtractive process were red, yellow, and blue, as these were the colors that painters mixed to get all the other hues.
Those pigments.
Yes. As color printing emerged, they were subsequently replaced with cyan, magenta, yellow, and key or black. That gives you the CYMK.
Got it.
As this color combo enables printers to produce a wider variety of colors on paper.
Very interesting.
Humans see colors in light waves, as we've mentioned previously. Mixing light, or the additive color mixing model, allows you to create colors by mixing red, green, and blue light sources of various intensities.
Mm.
The more light you add, the brighter the color mix becomes. If you mix all three colors of light, you get pure white light. TV screens and projectors use red, green, and blue, that's RGB, as their primary colors, and then mix them together to create other colors.
You know, it was interesting when I was younger, my father used to say that, think of it like this, black is the combination of all pigment, and white is the absence of all pigment, And then in light, white is the combination of all color, all rays, while black is the absence of all color rays.
That's a good way of looking at it.
It kind of flip-flops. This is actually really fascinating. Please continue.
So, why should game devs care about the color mixing models?
Okay.
Let's say you want to have a sunny yellow house in your town. If you don't use the correct color process, your house will appear muddy instead of that sunny yellow.
Ooh.
That's why, when working with graphics for any screen, use RGB, not CMYK.
Hello, Kia. Welcome to the stream. And yes, this is color theory. This is, we've been talking this one up for a while now. We decided now's a good time to get to it. A lot of the later graphical presentations we want to give rely on this one. So this is kind of a good starting point for anyone who wants to get the graphical parts of the Creator Classroom done. Now, I do want to add on before Teal moves on that it is good to know CYMK.
Yes, it is.
Especially if you're going to do any print media at all. This includes posters for your game. So the way you create your character and how they look when you have them on the screen, you have to change that color mixing model.
Yes, you do.
And
if you try to print using RGB, you're going to come up with a mess.
You are going to come up with a mess. Hello, Linky. Welcome to the stream. Green hair waifu is best. That is hilarious. But actually, Linky, when we get into colors, you'll see why green works for you. There's actually a psychology behind all of this. And Kia, that's fascinating. Please let us know at the end of the presentation what you think. As we said at the very beginning, Kia, and to anyone else who's joining us, this is just a primer. Entire books and courses, way beyond the scope of a 2 to 3 hour classroom, have been written on this.
Yes.
Hello, Boba Hotep. Welcome to the stream. Thank you for the slime of culture.
It's definitely an appropriate slime for tonight.
Yes, it is. Ha-ha.
Well, let's move on.
Let's move on.
A color has three properties. Hue is how the color appears, such as it's red. Chroma is how pure the color is. This property is split into three variations. A shade is a hue that has black added to it.
Uh-huh.
For example, red plus black equals burgundy.
There you go.
A tint is a hue that has white added to it, such as red plus white equals pink.
Mm-hmm.
And a tone is a hue that has gray added to it. This darkens the original hue while making the color appear more subtle and less intense.
Absolutely.
Finally, the last property is lighting. Lighting is how pale or saturated the color appears.
Welcome to the stream, Zarslo. Welcome to color theory. Basics, actually. A primer. That is true, Kia. College teaches you some pretty amazing things, and color theory in a formalized classroom, especially where you have some kind of a lab or studio, is really the best way to learn this.
It's amazing.
Yes.
The deep dive you can go into in a college course.
Absolutely.
With the proper lab.
This is, on a side note, the most difficult course that I took when I went and got my degree in game development. This was the hardest. I thought it was going to be something like calculus. No, it was color theory. This one beats your brain and makes you think in terms of color. And you look at what Teal just talked about with this wheel here, the hue,
chromas,
right.
Lighting,
all of that. You need to consider every single piece of that. They're all parts of a puzzle. There's a reason why there's 0 to 255, aka 256 shades of red, green, and blue in a normal RGB wheel. And nowadays, you can go even further. The human eye can only see so many shades of color, but each color invokes a different thing. So you have to take that into account. Kia says, I was the opposite, but I was getting that BFA. Yeah. It's still, painting gradients is your jam. That's awesome. Yes. Those gradients where you add the tone in and it either goes from like the richness color to the grayish color, or you pull down the saturation, those really teach you so much about how the actual color moves as you change those sliders. You know, if you ever have Photoshop, get into just the color picker and just move those sliders around for a while and just watch as the color changes and kind of get an idea on how all that works. Go ahead, Teal.
Okay. Do I have any questions so far?
Yes. By the way, this is going to be a lot of Teal talking and me interjecting as well.
Please, if you have a question about anything on the slides, type it up, mm-hmm. or you can save your question for the end. Either one. As I said, this can get to be a complex subject, so we'll be walking you through it.
Right. If you're comfortable just listening, that's fine. But as with all of our classrooms, please feel free to say at any point in time your thoughts on something or a question or how is this applicable to this part of my project. We're here for you guys.
Okay. I will move on.
Please move on.
When using color, you want to achieve harmony.
Oh, yeah.
In visual experiences, harmony is something that is pleasing to the eye. It engages the viewer, and it creates an inner sense of order, a balance in the visual experience. When something is not harmonious, it's either boring or chaotic. At one extreme is a visual experience that is so bland that the viewer is not engaged. The human brain will reject understimulating information.
It does.
At the other extreme is a visual experience that is so overdone, so chaotic, that the viewer can't stand to look at it. The human brain rejects what it cannot organize, what it cannot understand. The visual task of game developers is to present a logical structure. Color harmony delivers visual interest and a sense of order.
So Zarsla says that she did a unit on this in school and it's a nice refresher, and we're grateful. We're glad we can, you know, help refresh that, because this is an important skill set. Another thing, and Teal and I were talking about this when we went over this particular course and we're getting it ready. There's a reason why children and things related to children have very high saturated levels of color, what we would consider chaotic. Their brains and the way they process information require that overstimulation. They need all that chaos in order to pull data from, because their brains are still developing.
Yes.
But as a brain matures, it needs less and less and wants less and less of that. That's why if you go into a place where you have a lot of senior citizens, like a retirement community, you will see less saturation of color. Because as you get older, your brain needs less and less to pull information. And in fact, as you get older, more chaos is more uncomfortable. As Teal said, the brain rejects it.
Yes.
So harmony is the most important, especially for a game developer. But keep in mind that you can bring yourself towards boring a little bit to give a message and bring yourself in the other direction to give another message. But overexposure in either direction creates a negative result.
Yes, it does.
Balance is always is key.
So, how can you achieve harmony in your game maps, your user interfaces, etc.? Through the use of color schemes and color temperature. I just want to say that layout of objects on a map or elements in a UI menu are outside the scope of this classroom.
Right.
We can talk about how they contribute to design harmony in a later presentation.
Yes.
In the following slides, I will show you each color scheme and describe it in more detail.
Reverie says, mm-hmm. You can make use of one extreme just to highlight the other, i.e. making use of negative space. That is correct. I'll let Teal expand more on this point, but by using a color and bring it up to an extreme level or bring it down to an extreme level like a lack, you can create emphasis. A fantastic use of this is in the movie Schindler's List.
Yes.
Where in they do it in Sin City too, but in Schindler's List there's that one scene where the little girl with the red dress, and that's the only color you see is that red dress, and that focuses Oscar Schindler's view, Liam Neeson's character, on that girl. Also in Sin City, the color blood is usually a highly contrasted white or yellow or something that also emphasizes it. So in both of those cases, they took a black and white movie and added one element of color.
Yes.
In order to draw the attention of the main character to an extremely important focal point of development. in the other instance, in Sin City, they contrasted out one color completely to kind of comic book the violence,
mm-hmm.
and make it so that this highly over level, I mean, this insane amount of violence in Sin City becomes suddenly comic book level palatable. It also brings out a really huge moment when the yellow bastard appears.
Yes. So, yes, Reverie, and you, there are instances where you can use that type of, you can use either go more onto the boring or the chaotic side to emphasize a point.
Mm-hmm.
But again, you're emphasizing a point. You don't linger on that. The entire movies aren't typically like that.
Right.
Most games that you'll develop aren't like that. But you will have scenes in your games where you might want to employ that technique. Again, that's outside the scope of this workshop on basics, but that is something to keep in mind.
Absolutely.
And knowing these basics, you can play around with it and achieve the mood that you want to achieve.
Exactly. Using these basics, you can decide what are you trying to say with your color. All right,
we're talking about color schemes.
Buckle up, guys.
The first color scheme is monochromatic. Most people think monochromatic in terms of grays.
Right.
And that's not the full scope of monochromatic. Monochromatic is you take one hue and you create other elements from different shades and tints of it. As you can see from this chart, we took a basic teal tone. Teal, see what I did there? And we made shades by adding black to the basic color. And we made tints by adding white. And we made tones by adding gray.
That's right.
You have this entire color palette just on this one hue of teal. And you can design so many different objects. You can even design an entire room in a monochromatic scheme. Again, calling back to the earlier comment from Reverie, you can do this to emphasize a particular point in your map.
There you go. Doing a complete shift in one direction or the other will add that emphasis through saturation, desaturation, etc.
Right. And you're using light descriptors,
right,
rather than color descriptors.
A good example of a monochromatic scene are the sepia-toned dream sequences that are prevalent in so many games and movies.
You take that one particular hue of brown,
right,
and you mix it. You make shades, tones, and tints out of it, and you achieve a perfectly balanced monochromatic color scheme.
That just so happens that both over time and through the social perception is associated with dream sequences or flashbacks.
Old photographs.
And that's exactly where it's from, is that same color that was used in the development of old photographs.
That's right.
So what they did was they just took something that people remembered at the time and associated with something old and transposed it into, hey, this is a callback to something old, and over time it's become the accepted social norm. Kia says, that just reminds me of like every movie that has a scene takes place in Russia. Yes, absolutely, Kia. But that's the idea.
Mm-hmm.
It's your brain automatically thinks old.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Okay, moving on. Another color scheme is called analogous.
Not analogous.
No, please, not analogous. It's analogous. You're using three colors located beside one another on the color wheel,
mm-hmm.
such as orange, yellow, orange, and yellow to show sunlight.
Yes.
A variant is to mix white with these to form a high key analogous color scheme.
Yes.
Such as flames.
A very good, if I may. Mateel.
Okay.
The title screen, my brain went blank for a second. The title screen to Trailblazer utilizes an analogous title, analogous color scheme specifically for this. in order to create that sunset feeling. And it is a sunset, but
yes,
a sunset's a perfect example of an analogous color scheme.
Yes, it is.
Or a sunrise, either one.
Either one.
And it instantly creates in your mind a certain, this is what's happening. So whenever you have an analogous color scheme, you're creating in the person's mind a feeling of something they can associate with. You know, a sunset, a sunrise, blood flowing, whatever, pick something. You know, old wet stone. All right,
let's move on. Okay, you have your complementary color scheme. You use opposite color pairs, such as blue and orange, to maximize contrast. Using a complementary color scheme will give you a strong visual impact.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, if you use blue in a room and you put pops of orange here and there, that's very striking.
Probably the most famous example of this in the world is the red and green for Christmas.
Yes. As you can see, red and green are on opposite sides of the color wheel.
This was done on purpose from a marketing standpoint as Christmas became more commercialized, simply because it was easy to pop. It popped.
Yes.
It worked with the green Christmas trees. The opposite was red, so they started to red presents, red holly berries, etc. Red cans of Coca-Cola, red Santa Claus outfit. The two have become so synonymous that when you see red and green, most people automatically think of Christmas now.
Right.
And that shows how powerful that is. Isn't red the color the brain notices the fastest or something? Asks Rilo. And welcome to the stream, Rilo.
Yeah, welcome to the stream. And yes, it is.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go over what each of the colors evoke psychologically a little later on in the presentation.
Right.
But red is a color that it pops.
Yes, the brain immediately knows what it is. Mm-hmm. We have to, after all, figure out why Linky likes the green-haired waifus. Let us continue.
I personally like using the complementary color scheme when I design a modern-looking room map.
Yes, yes.
Complementary color schemes are actually modern. If you're designing something in a prior era, such as Victorian or Regency,
right,
you're not going to use a complementary color scheme.
No, you're not. This also helps for modern, postmodern. The Fallout series, for example.
Yes.
Uses a lot of complementary color schemes.
It uses complementary color schemes and also monochromatic.
You will find out, Rilo. We will find out soon enough. Kia says, I had a complimentary phase, and oh boy. Kia, I think we all had.
I think we did too, yes.
It's actually funny because, as Teal has talked about before, her office is actually supposed to be an Atomic Age style office.
Yeah.
So she actually has the blue and orange pop.
I do.
In a number of places. And it looks really good, but when I walk into her room, I really feel like I'm walking into Fallout 4's prologue.
Yep.
Okay.
All right. The next color scheme we'll discuss is split complementary.
Oh, this one.
It's also known as compound harmony.
Mm-hmm.
You add colors from either side of one of your complementary colors in the pair. So in this example, the complementary pair would be yellow and purple.
Right.
However, split complementary, you'll have yellow, then you'll have blue, purple, and red, purple.
Sorry, go ahead.
This harmony has a strong visual contrast.
Yes.
Similar to the complementary color harmony, but with less tension because three colors are used instead of two. This scheme is commonly found in nature.
Right. So the question that I was going to ask that you answered is, where is one mostly going to see this? And as Teal said, in nature, I'm going to go ahead and be a little more specific.
Sure.
Flowers. Flowers use split complementary or compound harmony all the time because by using the one color with its two adjacent contrasts, contrasting adjacents, however you want to put it, it catches the little bees and insects and other people's attention.
Mm-hmm.
They pull it in. They can see it easier. Bees and other insects don't see the world like we do. So they need to have a contrast that's like a landing pad. Come here and pollinate me, baby.
Yeah.
That's how it works. Nature finds a way to... In fact, nature is better at using pigment to drive home a message than any human has ever been.
That's right.
So if you... And this is actually a good developer take note moment. If you really want to see how color can be used effectively, watch how animals react to nature's color.
Yeah, think about the poison arrow frog.
Oh, yeah.
From South America.
Oh, that sucker.
Or the king snake.
Yes, the king snake. Exactly. Nature finds a way to use color to get a message across, and you as a game developer, once you learn that and learn from it, can use nature's tricks to really get your players to think a certain thing just by showing it in a coloration. All right.
The next color scheme is triadic. You take three colors which are equally distant on the color wheel. In other words, they're 120 degrees apart. In this example, we have red, blue, yellow.
The primaries.
These colors may not be vibrant, but the scheme can be, as it maintains harmony and high contrast.
Yes.
It's easier to make visually appealing designs with this than with a complementary scheme.
Absolutely. Kia says them primary boys.
That's right.
It's a true story.
The thing is, you take a look at this using yellow, blue, and red.
Right.
And you do have, it is a striking image. It does have pop. But it's more it's more harmonious than simply using blue and orange.
Exactly.
Or yellow and purple.
Right.
So that there is definitely a place for triadic in your design maps and your UIs.
A lot of children's rooms will use some sort of triadic scheme.
Yes, they will.
Because, again, it'll be high saturations of colors on that chaos end. Mm-hmm. But the triadic coloration, the fact that there is harmony there, can cause a more relaxing effect. Study rooms in elementary schools will often have a triadic scheme.
Classrooms as well.
Triadic. Thank you. That's what I meant. Yes. Zarsla says, does it have to space within three colors between? Can it be two or one?
It must be. It must have. They must be 120 degrees apart.
Right.
For triadic.
So right here in this wheel, you're seeing just certain wedges. These are just certain colors. But you can theoretically do it with any three colors as long as they're, as Teal says, 120 degrees apart.
Because they need to be equally distant.
Right. It makes a triangle.
Yes.
It's triadic, yes. All right.
An equilateral triangle.
Triangle. There's your math lesson for the day, everybody. But that's a good question, Zarsla, because what you're talking about where you have just two or one, that's not triadic. That's more anagalous. Well, actually, I'm not sure what that would be. That would be more anagalous. Anagalous. Me mispronouncing it, wouldn't call it analogous. Because I said, don't call it analogous. Go right. Steal. But it's more that on that end. Because you're getting closer to, you know, one.
Well, we are discussing basic color schemes.
Right.
There are any combination of colors you can
Absolutely.
Use.
Absolutely.
That don't necessarily fall into one of these basic schemes.
Yeah, please don't think that you're limited to the schemes. You're not.
No, these I'm simply pulling out the most basic schemes that are the most commonly used.
Right, so to answer Zarsla's question from that standpoint, you could have like red, orange, yellow, and that is a color scheme.
Yeah, it is.
But that's not one of the color schemes we're going over. That's its own thing. And it's a warm tone, really.
It's warm.
Yeah.
Now we get to a little bit more complex schemes. The tetrachromatic scheme.
Yeah.
You take four colors that are two sets of complementary pairs, such as blue and orange and yellow and violet. So you'll have orange, yellow, blue, violet.
Kia went ahead and said the two-spaced one is a quadratic color scheme. So I guess you're talking square, which we'll get to that one, Kia.
Of course.
But I think I know where Kia's going with that one.
Okay.
Yes. So this one is a skip one, skip three on this wheel to get back to Tetra.
No, it's not. It's two sets of complementary pairs.
Okay. Let's get back to that. It's okay. Good deal.
Okay. So you can have red and green and blue and orange.
Okay. I see. Okay. So red and green, blue and orange. I got it. So you take two that are automatically opposed to each other,
yes,
across from each other, and then use them together.
That's right.
Okay.
Doing this allows for rich and interesting designs.
Okay.
However, watch the balance between warm and cool colors. Most importantly, when you're using a tetrachromatic scheme, you want to choose one dominant color and have the other three be accent colors.
So like for this one, you could choose red.
Yes.
And then have the others be the accents.
That's correct.
Okay.
Because you're using two sets of complementary colors.
Yeah.
That's double the wham, double the pop. And if you use them all equally, it's overwhelming. You get to that chaotic mode again.
Now you're getting more into actual color schemes that are used for art styles and such.
Yes.
Trying to paint a picture that relays a certain piece of information.
Mm-hmm.
I got it.
When you're designing a room in your map.
Yeah.
If you're using the tetrachromatic color scheme, you'll choose one dominant color for the room. Let's say, you know, you have a yellow.
Okay.
Then you'll use purple to have maybe a rug. A small rug is purple.
Okay.
Maybe some yellow and purple in it. And okay. I'm just pulling this off, you know, rolling right. this out. And then you'll have red and green accent pillows scattered around. Yeah, sounds like a nightmare what I'm describing. But that's what I'm trying to get at is you'll have a dominant color in the room and you'll use the other three as your accents.
Well, right. And also, please keep in mind to everyone out there, Teal's not saying choose that yellow, that violet, that purple, that red, that green, because you can add those tones, those shades, those tints.
That's
just,
right.
Just because you have a yellow room doesn't mean you have to have a bright red pillow and a bright purple throw rug.
Right.
You know, one of those things that's really the reasons why we taught you about hue and light and
hue, shade, and tint.
Thank you, sweetie. The reason we taught all that ahead of time is so that when you're going through this, you can think, hey, okay, so these are colors get dulled down. These get ramped up. This one gets more tone to it, so it's duller. This one gets more black to it, so it's darker, a higher shade. This one gets more white to it.
I've got a perfect example.
So
let's say you have a pale yellow room.
Mm-hmm.
You can have a soft lavender rug.
There you go.
And pink a pink sofa.
Yes.
A blush pink.
Okay.
And you'll put spring green pillows on it.
There you go.
You instantly have a girl's room.
That's a girl's room. If you have an outside room, a quote unquote, you know, a outside area on your map, you could have a deep forest green for the basics, mm-hmm. and have patches of sort of lighter red flowers, and then every now and then have little bundles of, you know, light purple and almost sunshine yellow weeds sticking out.
Mm-hmm.
Things like that. It's learning to work with all those pieces parts, like Teal said, to make it into a coherent color scheme.
That's right. And you had your dominant color be the green.
There you go.
All right. The square color scheme.
Which, that's what we were talking about.
That's Kias. Right.
It's all good.
A square is a variant of tetrachromatic.
Yes.
You will find four colors evenly spaced on the color wheel. They're 90 degrees apart. Unlike tetrachromatic, square schemes can work well if you use all four colors evenly.
Aha.
So in this example, we have orange, green, blue, and a red purple.
Yeah, red purple.
So yeah.
There you go.
It's very balanced.
Mm-hmm.
It creates harmony.
It does.
Within the viewer.
Yeah.
And it's pleasing to look at.
It is. A lot of your interior decorators will use a square theme for a room.
Yes, they will. It's perfectly balanced.
Yes. Put on your Home and Garden Network and watch any of the interior decorating shows.
Yes.
And you will watch a lot of square color themes coming out.
Mm-hmm. It's very popular.
It is. All right. So the whole point of all the... Are we done with the color schemes? Or do we have any more?
We are finished with the basics of color schemes.
Right. Again, all of these are basics. Absolutely none of this is beyond primer level. But you want to understand your color scheme, because when you're designing your map, whether it be an external map, internal map, out and outer space, it doesn't matter. You want to have a color scheme. It unifies that color look. And you have to have some level of unification. Otherwise, it looks like, and we have seen this in games that we have played before, you're just literally throwing color at the scene. And that becomes chaotic. And when you create that chaos, or that boringness,
then the player's brain just turns off, and they're disengaged.
Exactly. There's a reason why games like Persona 5 are so popular, because the color scheme that they use literally pops when they want it to pop and dulls when they want it to dull. Also, games like what we're playing, Dragon Quest 11.
Yep.
They use very full, rich colors, and you can tell the color schemes work because every piece of nature, every dungeon, every character, even the luminary with his purple ass outfit and his silly hair, it works.
Yeah.
It creates a harmonious look.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
And let's talk about color temperature.
Oh boy.
When designing a map, determine how the color temperature, that is, your use of warm, neutral, and cool colors, to reflect your locale.
Yep.
For example, you can make a neutral color such as gray either warm or cool, depending on whether it is for a stone wall in a sunny climate or a dungeon-like prison beneath a castle. And what I've shown on the screen are two versions of the color gray.
That's right.
On the left is warm gray, mm-hmm. and on the right is cool gray.
So
it is the same hue.
If your brain is saying, no, that's brown, no, that is not. That is gray that has been warmed.
Yes.
The other one is gray that has been cooled. I have a lot to add on to this when you're ready.
Oh, go ahead.
Okay.
There's so much to say about color temperature.
Color temperature is probably the most important thing you're going to learn when you start getting into lighting your scenes. The temperature of your light affects the temperature of your light. The temperature of your light affects how your textures appear, and you want to have every texture and color choice in your scene work with that. Now, for those of you, yes, they can, Rilo, people have done that. They said it's a tan, but that's a totally separate thing. Okay. People often, now, if you're doing this in 2D, it's going to be a different methodology, so I'm talking about 3D for the moment. People often create a texture and then put it in a different lighting, and then find themselves beating their heads on the wall because what they created in Photoshop does not look that way in the game engine. There are many times you have to take your texture and tweak it so that it works under a different style of lighting. Hello, Gryphon. Welcome to the stream. And yes, brown isn't a real color. It's just dark orange.
It is. Brown is dark orange.
It is the perception of dark orange.
Yes.
So for 3D game designers, have a base neutral texture color and then be able to tweak it either warm or cold depending on if your scene is warm or cold. Don't rely just on changing the color of your light. And we saw that in Dragon Quest XI, the very beginning when we had a nighttime scene.
Mm-hmm.
And the textures weren't different. They just made the light blue and it looked terrible.
Yeah, it did.
We've seen the exact same thing in other games like Final Fantasy VII Remake, where they've changed texture color to work with light color and it looks very, very homogeneous. It's harmonious. It also depends on the engine you're using. I mean, there's 1,000 things to consider, but remember that you have to have texture color work with light color or it looks terrible.
Yeah.
same thing in a pixel-based engine, except you're faking the lighting all over. So if you are creating like an RPG maker or a game maker, a light map that lays over, and all that does is just change the, just puts a fake spotlight over there that's, you know, it's sort of a light yellow, and you just raise the transparency and it has attenuation. Make sure that when that goes over whatever your sprites are underneath, that your sprites work with that mixture. And if it doesn't, change the way the sprites work or change the way the fake, you know, spotlight looks. Otherwise, you're going to have this weird, uncomfortable coloration, and it turns your players off.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah.
Color temperature is just as important as the colors,
yes,
that you choose,
yes,
in neutral lighting.
So when Teal mentioned just a few minutes ago, the wall outside and the dungeon wall, you could have the exact same texture. But for the outside wall, you want to go ahead and add more warmth to it because the sun's going to be hitting it. You may even want to bring the tone up a little bit, add more gray because of it being sun bleached.
That's correct.
Then the one inside, you maybe bring up the saturation, lower the tone, so the color shows a little bit more, but then add a coolness to it because the interior light that hits it will make it look older. Now, a lot of what we're talking about is starting to move beyond and going into scene lighting and texturing and stuff, but it's important to know this because so many people underplay color temperature. From my film background, I can tell you that 90% of lighting a scene is getting exactly the right light temperature and the right amount on the subject. And that's overlooked on amateur level for both film and games. All yours, Teal.
Okay. So let's talk about color theory in practice. You use color theory to match what your players want to see.
Right.
Your colors must reflect your design goal for the map or the menu you are creating.
Mm-hmm.
Is this a map of an English garden on a sunny day? Or is it a damp cave full of goblins?
Goblins.
You also want to maximize the psychological impact on your players.
Mm-hmm.
Different colors evoke different emotions and associations within people.
Yep. Interestingly enough, Teal,
mm-hmm,
Boba Hotep made a joke, but it's actually something we can poke at. He said, did he miss the part where they talk about the colors in Sayaka? All jokes aside, horror is going to use a different color palette.
Yes, it is.
Than fantasy or sci-fi. So knowing the genre of your game is exceedingly important to picking the right colors.
Because it is player expectation.
Yes.
If you're playing a horror game, you expect to see a lot of darker tones,
mm-hmm,
and shading.
Yes.
And cool light.
Yes.
On the cool light spectrum, you don't expect to see warm. You expect, nope, to see cool color temperatures.
Great case in point is Silent Hill 3.
Mm-hmm.
You see warm temperature in the very beginning of the game when Heather is at the... what do you call it? The shopping center.
Yes.
Before everything goes stupid. And you see warm tone at the very end when she's at her father's grave. That's it.
The rest of the game is a cool temperature. And a color scheme. They have monochromatic.
Mm-hmm.
And they also have analogous.
Yes.
But again, your players who are playing horror expect to see that. They don't expect to see... this beautiful, warm, sunny orange and this sky blue. They don't expect that.
Nope, they
do
not. But
the players of a fantasy game do.
Yes, they do. High levels of saturation, especially for the sky and the flora. Uh-huh. They expect to see flashes of color all over the place because it's a fantasy world.
Yes.
So just by choosing the genre of your game, you are partially choosing your color palette. And don't think for a moment that you can be the odd man out and choose a color palette for one game when you mean it for another. Yes, there are situations where you could choose like a horror palette for a fantasy game and it could make it work. But don't just think you're going to do it just to be different. You have to have a reason. There has to be a psychological motivation.
So that's right.
Why would you choose a horror palette for a fantasy game? Horror fantasy. If you're having a fantasy storyline where people are in constant danger and there's death all around you, you can do that. Sinuous Sacrifice, Hellblade. A Plague, Innocence, A Plague's Tale. Both of those use horror palettes, mm-hmm. but they're basically games during fantasy times.
So. Game of Thrones.
Game of Thrones is all horror and thriller palette.
So, also, you know, we talk about maps.
Yes.
But also think about your menus and your UIs.
Uh-huh.
You also want to have, think very, very hard about your color scheme for those.
Yep.
And how the color scheme in your menus, how does that tie into the color scheme of your game?
That's right.
You know, again, if you're designing a horror game, then your menus and AIs also need to be in darker tones, cool color temperature, etc.
There is a reason why the Final Fantasy series is known for its blue color, although we will get into a lot of that stuff in another creator classroom, because it's such a pop, natural, fantasy color that they use it for just about everything. There's a reason why games like Dragon Quest use that brown parchment color. It's just there because they want their UI to blend into the background.
It's like on a scroll.
Like on a scroll, yeah.
So, do we have any questions on this before I move on?
Right, because I believe we're about to move into the colors themselves.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so before we get to the all-important question as to why Linky likes green-haired waifus, does anyone have any questions so far? Because we're about to literally jump right into the colors. Give us a second anyway to wet our whistles.
Most important. Of course, thank you, important.
I'm sorry, that's a lot funnier than it should be. You know, I know I thought of another one that uses a horror tone very successfully, because it's effectively a horror game regardless of setting.
Mm-hmm.
Alien Isolation.
Oh, yeah.
Amazing use of color to fill the player with the dread of trying to hide from the xenomorph. We're about to find out. Padre, this is the important... This is the question the whole stream has been going towards.
All right.
All right, let's do this.
Let's look at each of the primary and secondary colors in detail.
In detail.
Red.
Red.
Are you going to echo everything I say, Steel?
Every single thing you say.
Red is a color of extremes.
It really is, says the redhead.
Listen to him. It's a, I'm going to make you red.
I know.
Okay.
Says my redheaded wife.
Mm. It's the color of passionate love, seduction, violence.
Oh, that too.
Danger.
Yep.
Anger. And wild adventure. Red is also a magical and religious color. Red was almost as rare and as expensive as purple in ancient days, a fact that may explain its magic and power.
I can't add anything without getting in any more trouble, so...
You're already in trouble, mister.
But, in all jokes aside, red is a color that, as was mentioned earlier by Rilo, it is one of the quickest the brain recognizes before literally any other color we will see red.
Yeah.
And there's a reason for that.
Some global meanings of red.
Yeah.
Red is one of the top two favorite colors of all people. Red is the most popular color used in flags, on flags in the world.
Yep.
Approximately 77% of all flags include red.
So chances are, if you're watching this, the flag of your nation has the color red in it.
Red districts sell sex and pornography in every European culture.
Very important.
Oh, I wanted to bring that out. Red light district, man.
Uh-huh.
Here are some unique meanings of red in different cultures.
Right.
Red is the color of good luck in Asia, and is the most popular color in China. Most Japanese children draw the sun as a big red circle. Red is an auspicious color for marriage. Brides in India and Nepal wear red saris. In Japan, a red kimono symbolizes happiness and good luck.
To cycle back very quickly before hitting the comments, what Rilo said about red being quickly recognizable. That is the reason why stop signs and most stoplights are red. Because you are going to see that color before anything else.
That's
and
right.
That is the hey, you're about to get into a bad thing. Accident happen. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Danger.
Danger.
Again, danger.
Yep. Leaky says, fun fact, in 40K, the color red makes things go faster for orcs. Yes.
I believe it.
And Leaky confirms that red is lucky. Awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Zarsla says, all languages have at least words for red, black, and white. Yes. He also says, wasn't red considered to be a masculine color, too? Absolutely, yes. Kia.
It is the color of power.
Yes. Back in the day, during the Victorian era and such, young boys would be dressed in pink.
We're going to get into that later.
Oh, excuse me.
Stop.
All right. I'll be quiet.
Be quiet.
Yep. Red-headed wife.
Mm-hmm.
Red.
I'll get Kia, to that in a minute.
We're being hushed, Kia.
Okay. Anybody else have something to say about the color red? Okay. Yep. Thank you, Boo Boo Hotep. Teal just is galloping.
Hey, but we're keeping it interactive. This is important.
No, you're just wanting to giggle.
Well, you're a red. You know.
Okay. Orange.
Orange.
Orange is a vibrant and polarizing color.
Yes.
People either love it or detest it.
True story.
It is the only color of the spectrum whose name was taken from an object, the popular fruit, the orange. It symbolizes energy, vitality, cheer, excitement, adventure, warmth, and good health. On the flip side, it can be seen as abrasive, crass, or cheap. It may suggest a lack of serious intellectual values and bad taste.
There is a reason why in the video game Kingdom Hearts, the villain Ansem has orange eyes.
Mm-hmm.
It's not because he's cheap or crass or abrasive. It's actually because he's supposed to be the antithesis of, he's energy.
Yes.
Pure negative energy.
Yes.
And if you notice, when you see the subsequent games, characters like Xemnas, the real Ansem. In fact, anyone who's overexposed to the dark energies gets orange eyes.
Mm-hmm.
It's because they're making a statement about energy. Oh, no, not Ansem. Yeah, Kia, sorry.
It's worth noting that there are many shades of orange.
There are.
And different meanings.
Mm-hmm.
Darker oranges offer a sense of comfort. Some are spicy, some are earthy.
Spicy.
Lighter oranges are soothing and healthy.
And all oranges are great sources of vitamin C.
Here are some global meanings of orange. Orange evokes the taste of healthy fruits bursting with juice.
It does.
Orange is associated with vitamin C and good health. It is also symbolic of autumn.
That's right.
Orange is the color of life rafts, hazard cones, and high visibility safety vests. So, many people associate orange with safety.
Right.
Here are some unique meanings of orange in different cultures. Orange is the color of prison uniforms in the U.S. Orange, or saffron, is a sacred and auspicious color in Hinduism. The middle traffic light is orange in France. In the UK, orange stands for the Northern Irish Protestants and has very strong religious and political significance.
Welcome to the stream, Rythane. Boba Hotep, that's hilarious. That's great. You got 10 Kingdom Hearts for $50. You just go ahead and you collect them Kingdom Hearts. But all jokes aside, orange has the unique ability to pop like red and yellow, yet mm-hmm. give its own individual meaning.
Yes.
And a lot of people will see orange not as between yellow and red, but see it as the pop of red, the quick recognition of red and the pop of yellow,
mm-hmm.
which is why you'll see it on safety cones. Orange pops more than just about any other color. Like, you will see orange if you see orange.
It has that quality of energy about it.
Right.
Energy and excitement.
So in your game, if you want something to be noticeable, a hue of orange is a fantastic way of doing it.
Absolutely. It also, because it's so warm.
Yes.
It is the easiest color to use to make your flames and your fires.
It is. It is. Most flames that you're going to see in games are particles of orange.
Yes.
So they'll use orange particle effects. They will use a little bit of red, very, very little bit, and a little bit of yellow, a little more, but most of it's going to be orange. Open up any texture pack and take a look at what fire looks like.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to see a lot of orange and some yellow and some white.
But mostly orange.
Mostly orange.
Okay, yellow.
Yellow.
Yellow is the most luminous of all the colors of the spectrum.
Luminous.
It's the color that captures our attention more than any other color.
Yep.
It's the... Steel.
Sorry.
It's the color of happiness and optimism, of mm-hmm. enlightenment and creativity, mm-hmm. sunshine and spring. Lurking in the background, though, is the dark side of yellow. Cowardice, betrayal, egoism, and madness. Furthermore, yellow is the color of caution and physical illness. Think of jaundice, malaria,
yep.
or pestilence.
A lot of times a person's skin will get a deep yellow to it, dark yellow.
Mm-hmm.
When they're really sick, a lot of it's because of the toxins in their system
mm-hmm.
going to the skin surface, jaundice, as Teal said. But over time, we have also associated that pigment right. with sickness.
Mm-hmm. With some kind of illness.
Right,
mm-hmm.
some kind of illness. Also, and this is going to be a little on the gross side, so I apologize.
Uh-oh.
A person's urine becomes a very dark amber when they are sick. An ichor color, actually, I think is the
hence
right color.
Why in your example of Sin City, they use the color yellow for...
Yellow Bastard, yeah.
For Yellow Bastard.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Because he is a sick individual. He tortures and rapes women. And
he's sick in both physical and mm-hmm. in mental.
So
because of what he does.
Right. So he's yellow.
Mm-hmm.
Yellow. Thank you,
well,
Rythane.
Well, that's true. You know,
it's true.
Rythane's right.
Yes. So because of all of that, it's been psychologically associated. So in your game, if you want to give an illness, put a yellow tone on something. You can overlay it, you know, use the additive method that Teal was talking about earlier
mm-hmm.
and bring that yellow in. It's gross.
Add a black to it to darken it.
Uh-huh.
And you can also use a gray.
Right.
To further make the yellow into its more negative side rather right. than its positive side.
But let's on the flip side. If you add a light sunny yellow, you can instantly happy up a scene, mm-hmm. make a scene happier.
Yeah.
So bring that yellowness up when you want to express success, happiness.
Or happiness, hope, optimism.
Victory, right. Yes, exactly. If you want to have a positive light structure, you know how we talked about lights on 2D maps, use a light yellow and use that as your light map or your RPG Maker or whatever your 2D map is
uh-huh.
and use a light yellow for your outside if you want your sunshine to illuminate positively your scene.
Yes.
And Kia says not to mention the uses. Exactly.
That's true.
Yellow is... Now, right, we'll get into green. You'll see in a second, Rythane.
But yes. A yellowish green, yes, to signify yes. acid or corrosion. Absolutely. Yes,
absolutely.
You add that yellow to that green
uh-huh.
to give your color a negative connotation.
Right.
Global meanings of yellow. In almost every culture, yellow represents sunshine, happiness, and warmth.
Yay.
Yellow is the color most often associated with the deity in many religions, such as in Hinduism or in ancient Egypt.
True story, yeah.
Yellow is the color of traffic lights and signs indicating caution all over the world. Some unique meanings of yellow in different cultures. In Japan, yellow often represents courage. In China, adult movies are referred to as yellow movies. In Russia, a colloquial expression for an insane asylum used to be yellow house. Also, an interesting point of history, those condemned to die during the Inquisition wore yellow as a sign of treason.
That I did not know.
Yes. That was an interesting fact that I dug up on yellow.
That is pretty good. Well, I mean, I guess it would help, especially during the reign of Torquemada, that he would colorize, you know, a shirt or a scarf or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Someone who's getting ready to be executed for, you know, heresy or treason against the Catholic Church. That's good to know. I mean, it couldn't talk him out of anything.
Mm-hmm.
All right, let's move on. Insert inappropriate joke here.
Let's move on to green.
All right, here we go. Where's Linky?
There's Linky. Since the beginning of time, green has signified growth, rebirth, and fertility.
There you go, Linky. That's why you like green-haired waifus.
In Celtic lore, the green man was a symbol of fertility.
Yep.
In Muslim countries, it is a holy color, and in Ireland, a lucky color.
Very much so.
During the Ming Dynasty, it was the color of the heavens. On the darker side, green symbolizes envy, immaturity, and nausea.
The other reason why Linky likes green hair. Hello, human. Welcome to the stream. And when you mentioned China, you're talking about the Jade. Jade,
yes,
Emperors.
The Jade Emperor.
Yes. Fantastic.
Global meanings of green. Green is universally associated with nature. Green symbolizes ecology and the environment. Traffic lights all over the world use green for go.
Uh-huh. Green is always given some sort of motion. It pushes something forward, positive or negative.
Yes.
It is a moving color. And all jokes aside, Linky, more than likely the reason you like green-haired waifus is because of the fertility factor.
Mm-hmm.
It just clicks in your brain, this lady is fertile. I don't really know how nice to say that. He's saying Nani, but we all know the truth. But let's go actually and talk about a famous character with green hair.
Mm-hmm.
Tara Branford from Final Fantasy VI.
Yes.
She's a rebirth. She is the summation, the combination of human and Esper. A rebirth and a hope.
Nature. She's nature. Mm-hmm. Growth. You mentioned rebirth.
Yes.
Yes. But more than that, since green is the color of, we associate with nature.
Uh-huh.
Espers are very much tied to the planet, the natural world.
Right.
So her hair is green to reflect that.
Yep. Also, it kicks into the immaturity because she is effectively a child for most of the story.
Yes.
So it works in that regard. Having Tara Branford's hair green is a perfect choice.
I mean, when you say someone is green, you're meaning that someone is very new, young, immature.
Right.
You know, a greenhorn. You've heard of that mm-hmm. you know, in these old movies, the prospector. You're just a greenhorn.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or, you know, being green with envy.
Mm-hmm.
That's another one. And nausea. So earlier, Rythane said he used yellow or green to signify acid or corrosion. Exactly. By getting that certain bit of yellow and that certain bit of green,
mm-hmm.
you combine sickness and nausea to literally make something that's just unhealthy.
Like, also, yeah, and also think about your emoji for nausea or vomiting. You see the little guy, little yellow icon, and it's throwing up green barf. So, yeah. I mean, there's that. I had to bring that up.
It's okay. Another good innocence, another good immaturity innocence, one Serena from Dragon Quest XI. Her default dress is green.
Yeah, it's green because she herself is immature.
Yeah, she's a very innocent person. So that's the reason why that green is the way that it is. It is a very strong color, but it's also a color that always pushes forward some sort of momentum.
So let's take... Uh-huh. Are you finished? Because I want to...
I am done.
Okay. I have some a list of unique meanings of green in different cultures.
Oh, boy.
In China, green may symbolize infidelity.
Uh-oh.
A green hat symbolizes that a man's wife is cheating on him. In Spain, racy jokes are green. Green is a lucky color in most Western cultures. A green shamrock symbolizes this.
Yes.
However, you won't find many green cars at racetracks because they are considered unlucky.
True.
And if you're familiar with children's nursery rhymes, there's an old English rhyme about wedding colors. Married in green, ashamed to be seen.
Wow.
And that is something that we would definitely bring up in the Rosenhearts game, or any game set in a Victorian or Regency era.
Right. You would not have green as your wedding color.
You would not use green in any way, shape, or form as a wedding color.
Now, that was then, this is now, because green is also associated so much with spring. I don't know if that was a note or not. I'm not trying to...
No, you're fine.
Okay, so green is so associated with spring that nowadays, spring weddings will incorporate green.
Yes.
Because the paradigm has shifted.
That's why I said in Victorian or the Regency era.
Right.
That rhyme was, that's where it came about.
Right.
But in our modern era...
Modern era.
Mm-hmm.
I have to take my headset off. Hold on.
It's okay. Pretty much anything goes. Green is fine.
Mm-hmm.
Any combination of green.
Yes.
Teal. Yellow green. Spring green.
That's right. The beautiful thing about the color green is that it is very versatile, and since it's so associated with life, you can use it for almost anything.
Mm-hmm.
Green does make a very good base color for a lot of scenes, especially your outdoor ones. You're going to use it
scenes.
A lot.
Mm-hmm.
But the absence of green in an outdoor scene means an absence of life in most people's minds. Deserts, rocky crags, other planets like Mars. People are going to think less life if they see less green. So we're already hardwired to view green as the life color.
Just think about the maps in Fallout 4, for example. Most of the outdoor maps, you don't see green.
No.
You know, you see different combinations of orange, yellow, gray, and black.
And then when you get to one place that is very green, the Glowing Sea, this is a juxtaposition and a very smart move on Bethesda. The greenest place in Fallout 4, the Glowing Sea, has the type of green that brings out the thoughts of nausea.
Yes.
So this was actually a very brilliant move on their part.
Mm-hmm.
So I know we're spending a lot of time on green, but green is one of those colors that it really is important to understand how it works as a game designer. You create momentum. You create life when you add the color of green, and you create a feeling of either artificial life or a lack of life when you take it away.
That's correct.
So, developers, take note. That's how you do.
Right. Blue.
The most important color ever.
Blue has more complex and contradictory meanings than any other color.
Kind of like me.
Right. These can be easily explained by pinpointing the specific shade of blue.
Right.
Dark blue evokes trust, dignity, intelligence, and authority.
Hello.
Bright blue indicates cleanliness, strength, dependability, and coolness. Light or sky blue, peace, serenity, ethereal, spiritual, and infinity. Most blues convey a sense of trust, loyalty, cleanliness, and understanding. On the other hand, blue evolved as a symbol of depression in American culture.
It is.
It is cold and wet, in contrast to red's heat and dryness.
Also true. Before you go any further, the reason that we chose Studio Blue as Studio Blue, besides another reason Teal will read off momentarily, is because it comes in with that whole understanding and trust, you know, basic... Yes, thank you, Harvey Dent. Hello, Center... Centuriu, welcome to the stream. Thank you. So, yes, we chose blue for Studio Blue because it invokes those feelings.
Yes.
We wanted to... We promote ourselves as subject matter experts, and we wanted to use blue because of its tick onto understanding and intelligence. I know that's a bit self-aggrandizing, but you do choose colors based off of the message you're trying to get across.
Correct.
So...
Yeah, and they teach you that in marketing.
They do. And I will give my wife absolute credit. She's the one who chose the color because she said, and here are the reasons, and she laid them out to me, and I went, that works, let's do it.
Here are some global meanings of the color blue. Blue is the number one favorite color of all people.
And it is Steel's favorite color.
53% of the flags in the world contain blue.
That means 53% of the flags are awesome. Now stop.
Blue is the most commonly used color in corporate identity.
Mm-hmm.
Aristocracy is blue-blooded in all European languages.
Yep.
Some unique meanings of blue in different cultures. Greeks believe that blue wards off the evil eye. Dark blue is the color of mourning in Korea. The god Krishna has blue skin. So blue is... It is a color that is used quite extensively for loyalty, to convey that sense of loyalty and dependability.
Right, as well as to
trust. I'm there for you.
Yes. Intelligence. Mm-hmm. Wisdom. In fact,
wisdom. Definitely wisdom.
One version of the Canadian flag was blue with a maple red. That's true, Boba Hotep. But let's go a step further, because you talked about Krishna.
Yes.
Okay. And authority. Thank you. Thank you, Yorkshire. I was about to add on to that. So because of trust, intelligence, authority, that is why when the Italian painters started to paint Jesus of Nazareth, they gave him blue eyes.
Yes, they
for
did.
For that very reason. You give someone that piercing blue gaze, you immediately think, I need to listen to this person. They're wise, they're intelligent, and they're in charge. So blue also has, like you said, that corporate identity. That was the other real reason. The corporate identity, it being my favorite color, was actually irrelevant. We chose Studio Blue because corporate identity and all the reasons that Teal mentioned earlier. But also when you see blue, you immediately think, and this is going back to both why we chose blue, as well as why a lot of places and companies, as well as authorities, choose blue. You immediately think expert.
Yep.
You think that whatever this person is presenting, they automatically are an expert.
Yeah.
So you have a blue police uniform. This person knows what they're talking about in the terms of law enforcement. Excuse me. You see a blue logo for a company. This logo can be trusted. This company can be trusted. So you use blue in your games when you want to invoke that feeling of either expertise, trust, loyalty, etc. This is not the case for Walmart. Well, this is true. Walmart has blue on its logo simply for being, hey, you can trust us for the best deal. Customer loyalty, that kind of thing.
Right.
It's not because they're, yeah, not for the other reasons.
Mm-hmm. All right. Oh, one more little fact.
About blue?
Yes.
What's up?
Blue is for a baby girl and pink for a baby boy. That's in true. Belgium.
Yep. And now may we talk about it?
Yes. Now you may discuss it.
So back during the Victorian era, the Regency era, basically everything prior to really the early 1900s, pink was what you dressed baby boys in.
Yeah.
Blue is what you dressed baby girls in.
Mm-hmm.
And men wore pink.
Yes, they did.
With style. Because that was a masculine thing to
do. Pink is a masculine color. It's a variant of red. Blue was a feminine color.
Right.
Because it was evoking of the softness and calming. It was very calming and that sort of thing. You know, right. That's the way, you know, women were, okay, we're going to be calm now.
Very powdery and relaxing.
Yeah, relaxing.
Now, because of the way that society is shifting back towards being less restrictive on colors, you're starting to see men walk around with pink ties, pink vests. In fact, we went to that wedding last year. One of the people there wore a strapping young man wore a pink vest.
Yeah.
He looked amazing. A man can look as good in pink now as they could years ago. Just look at the color. Look at how it works with them.
Mm-hmm.
Just like a lady can look fantastic in powder blue, or any blue,
or navy blue.
Colors only are assigned genders because human beings and societies assign them.
That's correct.
If you take away that, if you take away the social impact of a color, and you look at the psychology of the color, then you can assign it to your character or your world or your map or whatever without worrying about, oh, you can't have pink hair. That's silly. Does pink hair work for your character? Does right. it give the message you want to give? Does blue hair work for your character? Does it work for your waifu? What does it say? Tenji Muyo was a fantastic example. The colored hair for Ryoko was sort of a light cyan, and that was loyalty. Loyalty for Tenshi. Sasami and Tsunami had a deeper blue, and that was that wisdom.
Right.
So, you know, you can use any color hair you want for any character, any color clothing for any character, as long as it gets across what you want with them, you're fine.
Yeah. All right. Purple.
I just realized Kia said, you can trust Walmart to let them shop in PJs. We've all done it.
We have. Purple's rarity in nature and the expense of creating the color.
Actually, Teal, Kia brings up a good point before we move on.
What?
Wasn't the pink-blue shift we see nowadays due to marketing?
Yes.
Totally.
Mid-century. It happened mid-20th century.
Yep.
I did study that at one point. I've forgotten the exact reason for the shift.
Uh-huh.
But I do know that it did come in the mid-20th century, and it did have to do with marketing. And for the life of me, I can't remember why. Maybe you know why, Kia.
Kia's saying she can't remember either.
Yeah.
But the reality is this. It happened.
Yeah.
And it was purely a marketing reason. There was no psychology behind it.
No.
And that's okay. And that shows in our society nowadays that we're shifting back to the previous perception. And now actually we're becoming more inclusive, where it's the color that works for the person.
Right.
Not the color that's associated with a gender, sex, identity, etc. And apparently we have a purple haired waifu and Linky jealous. So let's move on to purple.
Okay. Purple's rarity in nature and the expense of creating the color has given purple a supernatural aura for centuries.
Mm-hmm.
Purple symbolizes nobility and luxury to most people in the world. Purple symbolizes magic, mystery, spirituality, the subconscious,
mm-hmm.
creativity, dignity, and royalty.
Right.
It evokes all of these meanings more so than any other color. Variations of purple convey different meanings. Light purples are lighthearted, floral, and romantic. The dark shades are more intellectual and dignified. The negative meanings of purple are decadence, conceit, and pomposity.
Zarsla also brings up a good point, which we'll go over a little more in depth when we talk about how purple can be applied. But yes, purple equals corruption in games, like a character who becomes evil or poisoned.
Mm-hmm. So
the reason for that, in the most base, and this is like, I am super like top level here, because purple is easier to show than black in a game engine.
Yeah.
But it's a very dark color. That is why. The psychology behind it is still there, and we'll get into that. But dark, dark purple used for clouds of darkness is because it's easier to see that than black.
Also, if you use the purple along with green, it evokes poison.
Yes, like the poison clouds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like a person who's wearing purple and green.
Mm-hmm.
A good example is a designer designed a dress for an evil queen.
Yep.
And he used purple and green to mm-hmm. evoke the feeling that, okay, this is, she's evil, she's poisonous. And it worked.
Mm-hmm. In the game we're currently playing on Wednesdays, Dragon Quest XI.
Mm-hmm.
All of the times that dark energy appears in this game, it is a darker shade of purple.
Yes.
Up to and including the bad guy, Mortigan, having purple skin.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, they are going all the way with that trope. And Rythane says he uses pinkish purple to symbolize the arcane. Absolutely.
Yeah.
because you have the pop of red, which, remember, red is the most recognizable.
Yes.
Along with purple for mysticism, and it just looks and feels arcane.
Yes, it does.
A lot of arcane crystals you will see will have some level of purple in them.
Right.
I don't know anything about real life crystals, so I couldn't tell you there, but I do know that amethysts are gorgeous and have that sort of deep mystery in them.
Right.
I think amethysts are purple, right?
Yes, yeah. They are.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Also, purple is royalty. What are three, going back to religion for a second, what are three of the candles during Advent? The Christian Advent. They're all purple, right?
They're purple. Mm-hmm.
Right. And then one pink. So you use this to create an idea of mysticism, spirituality, kingship. And it's used outside of religions, but in religions it's used as much. I also believe it was rather expensive at one point.
That's what I said. Yeah.
That used to be.
It was very expensive mm-hmm. to create the color.
Yeah. Which is why it was only for kings. And then this is talking about the evolution of something over time. Purple wasn't always kingly, but because it was so expensive, only the rich and the kings could afford it. Ergo, over time, it became royalty.
Right.
So a lot of times nowadays, when you see a royal character, you'll see them in purple. In fact, if we could talk about games a little bit, or are you still going?
Well, it's fine. I have different global meetings to tell a purple. I mean, you can go ahead and talk about the games.
Let me just say this one thing. If you ever clad a character in purple and you give them a symbol of authority, people will automatically assume they're in charge. You give them like a purple cape or a purple cloak. And, oh, that's the king. Okay, go for it. Teal.
Okay.
Yeah.
Some global meanings of purple. Among Mediterranean people, purple was reserved for emperors and popes. The Japanese christened it imperial purple.
Uh-huh.
Purple is the color of mourning or death in many cultures, specifically the UK, Italy, Thailand, and Brazil. Purple is not a common flag color. In fact, only two flags contain purple, Dominica and Nicaragua.
Ooh.
Unique meanings in different cultures. The Purple Heart is the American award for bravery. Purple is a symbolic color for the gay community in many Western cultures. In Italy, most performing artists would not go on stage if they have to wear anything purple, because it is considered unlucky in show business.
Because of conceit.
Yeah. So purple has a very rich connotation.
Yep. The Purple Heart is a very good example of how the societal perception, the human perception of purple over the years. The United States does not have royalty.
No.
However, the United States is also built on the veneration of not only its leaders, but those who fight and sacrifice for it. The reason the Purple Heart is a Purple Heart is because of that. It is purple for the highest honor we can give you.
That is correct.
It's our version of knighting you.
That's right.
You know, I say our because we're from the U.S., but that's what it is. You give a purple connotation to something. Now, is there another reason that I'm probably not seeing? Yes. But from a color theory perspective, that's what it is.
I often use purple when I'm designing, fantasy maps of a wizard's
yes.
room or a mystic's room.
Mm-hmm.
I use the color purple a lot in those particular maps.
We use purple for Gray Morgenstern's vest.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't know if the original design we have posted has it, but the more updated ones, there's purple in his color scheme besides the gray because he's a wizard.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
You know, in fact, going to the Wayback Machine.
The Wayback.
The New Age movement of the 80s.
There you go.
Purple was used to signify spirituality, the subconscious.
Yes.
You know, your third eye was purple. That's what it was used for. So yeah, purple.
Yep. And I'm actually looking at the one of the original sketches of Morgenstern, and it is the older color. So yeah, we've shifted his vest to more of a purple now.
Yeah, because of the association right. with mystery and magic.
Mystery.
I mean, you'll see Goodness gracious, how many pictures of Merlin do you see? Merlin the Wizard, where his robes are purple.
Exactly, or the Wiz robes from Zelda.
Mm-hmm.
You know, purple. Some of the ones, or the little mage characters in Dragon Quest. You know, a lot of them are purple. Not all of them, but purple's used all the time.
Okay.
Purple Mountain's Majesty.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so I wanted to give you guys a couple of resources for color picking.
This is important.
Two resources I've used in the past and I highly recommend are the Pantone Institute's Color Picker and Dixon and Moe's Color Picker. Each site includes instructions for using their particular color picker and additional tools to aid you in building your color palette.
Yep.
The URLs for these two resources will be listed in the description of this video.
Every single really good interior decorator, set designer, etc., will use one of those, usually Pantone.
Usually it's a Pantone Institute.
You know.
But I do like the Dixon and Moe's color picker because you can actually, right there on the side, experiment with different harmonies.
Right. And another good reason why Dixon and Moe is often used by developers, game developers, is because it drops right into experimenting with those hex colors.
Yes.
But you could use either one.
Either one is good. I love the Pantone Institute because not only can I use their color picker, but they have lots of different articles on various colors and colors used in the fashion industry and the design industry, designing furniture, marketing materials, things like that. It's very fascinating. You can absolutely go down a rabbit hole there.
You can. I use Pantone whenever I'm either dealing with something in real life or I'm dealing with something in a game engine. But if I'm designing a website, I go to Dixon and Moe.
Yeah. So, and it's just how they're laid out.
It's pick the tool that works best for you.
Pick the tool that works best for you. And, oh, by the way, this year's color of the year is classic blue.
Oh, wonderful. So it's the year studio blue.
Yeah.
I've decided.
So that brings us to the end of our presentation.
There he is. You know, I've been wondering where the slime has been this whole time. He's getting ready to paint. That's awesome. A little bit.
He uses all of his knowledge of color theory now. He's going to make this beautiful picture.
That is going to be great. So, this is where we open things up to discussion. The presentation was an hour and a half, which went a lot faster than I thought it would. That's actually good. Because this is such a highly complex thing. Remember, to those who have watched, not since the beginning, this is a primer.
Yes.
You can take courses on Udemy. You can go to school. Kia even brought up this is a refresher.
All this is just it's a survey workshop. We're looking at it from the top down, just a broad overview, the basics.
The basics, because this is such a highly, highly complex topic.
Yes, it is.
Again, just talking about my past. Back when I went to school to get my game development degree, this was the most difficult course. And you wouldn't think it is. You're thinking like, oh, what they just talked about was easy. Red for passion, purple for royalty. We scratch the surface. And yes, as Kia said, you can go so deep.
Yes, you can.
Because, thank you. Thank you very much. So while you all are formulating any questions, I want to talk a little bit about how you can use these colors to affect your players.
Go for it.
Pick your primary color, whatever your focus color is. I think we're... Did I mention you mentioned a color? No, we did not talk about color blindness.
No, we did not.
So that is...
That is a separate subject. That was outside the scope of this basics workshop.
Right.
But utilizing color and color schemes to reach the color blind is a subject.
Its own thing.
Its own subject, yes.
Mm-hmm. I think Rythane's trying to say it's a gray area, but...
You're funny, Rythane.
But all jokes aside, it is. It's its own subject, Gryphon. You have to dig pretty deep in. That is because you have that point. You have to use contrasts in order to help the colorblind, because not every single person who's colorblind, in fact very few, only see shades of gray.
There's different types of colorblindness. You know, we all think of red green, but Just a little bit of research I did into it. There's different types.
There is.
Of color blindness. So yeah, that's a different subject.
That's a different subject, but it is a good point that Gryphon brought up.
Mm-hmm.
Because as you all out there watching this, whether it be live or on VOD, you can go and research that. Because you as a game designer should be thinking about the colorblind.
Yeah.
Because it's not as small a percentage of a populace as you'd like to think. A lot more people have it. Heck, I don't even think the same intensity. We don't.
No, we don't.
Let's go ahead and talk about cones. We've talked about cones before in our AMAs.
Cones in your eyes, in human eyes.
Thank you. Most humans,
you have rods and cones.
Right. Most humans only have three cones in their eyes.
That's right.
Meaning they only see a certain range of colors.
Red, green, blue.
Right. Certain people due to a genetic mutation have four cones in their eyes and they can see a far wider range of colors. Studio Blue actually has that dichotomy. Teal has three cones in her eyes. I have four. I've taken the test. I have four. Our friend, who's an artist, she has four. So I see the world differently than my wife does.
Yep.
So if you, and we can probably link in the description or on the Discord channel, take the test and actually do have four cones, you're going to see things differently. There's a test you can take that shows a gradient, and it's how many shades of that color you can see.
Yeah.
And you count them, and if you see over a certain amount, you have four cones. And we took the test, and Teal only saw this many, and I saw that many more.
Right.
What about those weird pics you can't tell, like gray and pink apart? I'm not sure what you mean, right, Thane. Do you know what that means, Teal?
No, I don't.
Hmm. I know he's not talking about an illusion picture, so, like Magic Eye. Rythane, if you can get a little more descriptive as to what that means. So, optical illusions. Yeah, optical illusions. Thank you. Hello, Chaos Streamer. Welcome to the stream. If Rythane's talking about those, the Magic Eye, that's different than a color thing. There's this one great Tales from the Quip episode on Yellow with Kirk Douglas. I don't think I've ever seen that, Yorkshire.
Oh, yeah, Kia, the blue dress meme from 5 years ago. That, yes.
Yes. Is it blue or is it? Yes.
Yeah. Is it? Let's see. It was like white and gold or blue and something.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. I see what Rythane's talking about. Okay. So not.
Yeah. That's the same as that dress meme. Yeah.
Yes. White and gold or
blue
and
black.
Right.
Yes.
Yes. That is two things. That's not just the cones in your eyes. That's also how lighting affects color. Because you look at the same dress in two different ways, in two different schemes, and it looks completely different, and then you get the world's greatest argument.
Yeah, it was wonderful.
Absolutely fantastic.
But yeah, the such things as the number of cones you have in your eyes affects how you see color, and it affects how you feel about a certain game.
Yeah.
If for instance, and I've did some research, people with four cones typically do not like the color yellow.
Typically they don't. There are certain shades of yellow that aggravate me, and there are certain ones I'm fine with. The closer it is to lemon yellow, the more it irritates me. The more pastels I'm okay with, and I get squicked by deep yellow. Like the ichre color.
Right.
That's awesome, Chaos. Well, I hope you're able to learn. We helped you out today. Every Monday is our creator classroom. Wednesdays and Thursdays are our critical plays, where we play a AAA video game and give critical commentary on how developers can do better, learning from the mistakes of the pros. And Friday is our AMA. Gotten really good at plugging this.
Yeah, you have. But getting back to the cones thing. So when you're designing a video game, keep that in mind.
Yes.
How much yellow are you putting into your scenes?
That's right, because some people are going to be squicked by it.
Mm-hmm.
Or put off by it.
Put off by it, and that's a shame, because your game will be the best you can get. You can develop, and if they just can't handle it because of all this yellow, well, yeah.
The thing is this, color theory is so deep that most people don't look at it from a stint of who is it going to push in or out. They look at it more like how is it going to draw someone in. And just as you can have an epilepsy warning, you can also have a color warning.
Now, yeah.
I'm not saying do that, but I'm saying you could technically. Right thing, I will. At the end of this, I will find it and I will go ahead and post it on the Studio Blue main chat. I'll probably post it in info, actually. Okay, so that's where I'll post the test. So let's actually talk about color while you guys are sending more questions. Great questions, by the way, every single one of you. When you're developing a character, a map, a particle effect, think about what you want to convey. Are you trying to convey a feeling of momentary flare-up of passion? That would be more of a red tone as your primary. Are you trying to think of something where it's more, you know, authoritarian, intellectual? That would be blue. Are you trying to promote life, then green? Human, I don't think that's possible. I don't, to my knowledge, there's no,
no,
that doesn't exist.
No, there's, humans will not have five tones, no.
Now, there are animals that see colors and light far better than we do, and there are animals out there that see a lot worse.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. I mean, we mentioned bees earlier. Bees literally see ultraviolet.
Yeah, they do.
They see ultraviolet like you see everything else. Kia, that was great.
Mantis
shrimp.
Wow.
Yeah. Also, do you think the fear of the virtual boy is part? I would say a number of reasons up to and including that. Whose idea was it thinking that red was the best primary color for that?
Wow.
I have no idea. You take something the size of a small toaster, slap it onto your face, while you're holding onto the controller and you're looking at a lot of red and black. That is not good.
That's terrible.
No. So that, I agree, human, that probably is. That's also probably the reason why the Game Boy did so well, other than the fact that it was awesome, is the fact that it had a very dull gray with just black pixels.
Yeah.
And it just did shapes. It relied on shapes, not so much hues. I think I lost my eyes because of Virtual Boy. Still have it in the box.
Yorkshire, no, we're not saying you only see three colors. What we're saying is most humans have three tones, and it's red, red, green, and blue.
Right.
And so your brain mixes these colors in together, and so that's why you can see all these different colors.
Right.
Everything is hitting those cones, which hit the spectrum of red, green, and blue.
Right. Humans see color 101. Here is literally Steel telling you how that works in one paragraph. Light comes in, hits an object. That object absorbs all light except for the light wave of the color you're going to see, whether it be blue, black, pink, etc. It hits your eye. Your eye determines the redness, greenness, and blueness of it and turns it into an actual color. Most people only have three of those things. Some people, due to a genetic mutation, have four. The ones with four can see a wider range of those colors.
Yeah.
That is literally how it works on a very top level.
So that makes our game design very interesting, because
yes.
With Steel, he'll see more subtle colors, and he may design a map with that, and I'll look at it and go, oh, why is there so much blue here?
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, well, no, this is this shade, this shade, and I said, I can't see it.
And then I know that I have to go back to the drawing board.
Yeah.
So if you are a four-cone artist, one, you're going to make some beautiful stuff.
Yes, you are.
Two, you got to take into account the rest of the world.
We can't see it.
We can't
see your brilliant work.
Right. And if it look, and if they're too close to each other, the different subtle parts of blue, then they're all going to look like the same blue, and they're going to be like, well, that's just a blue blob.
Yeah.
Great case in point, the little gradient design behind the slime that says Creator Classroom actually, to me, probably looks like a more vibrant gradient than it does to Teal.
Yeah.
So there it is. Just things like that. And you got to take that into account. That's the reason why whenever you have marketing, there's just this color here, this color here, this color here, and it makes a design. My color scheme is just too advanced for the world. Kia be superhuman. Rivery says, BYT, Vsauce has an amazing video on how we see color.
Yeah,
yes.
They do, yes.
Rivery, could you post that video? Could you
post
that
the link
to here, to this chat right here, so the viewers can see it? Could you see the blue coldness in Don't Die? Yes. Your Don't Die game looked cold because of blue. Never been so jealous of mantis shrimp.
Yeah.
There was one picture where all colors are used are shades of red, but when they see the whole picture, it looks normal.
Yeah.
Yes, because when you have enough shading, the human brain starts filling in the gaps. That's why animation works. Animation doesn't work because things are moving. Animation works because these pictures are so close that when they flippity flippity flip, the brain goes, oh, that's movement.
Yeah.
The human brain tries to optimize. Oh my gosh, I'm about to get scientific, and I promise I will get back into the game development after this. The human brain tries to optimize everything around it to use as little of synapses as possible to do the most work. That's why we're such effective computers in our brainy parts. Ergo, we try to fill in colors, shapes, light, sound, all of it. So you, as a game designer, can use color theory to fill in those gaps and allow your player's brain to infer an emotion, a feeling, or a sensation based solely off the colors you choose. Again, we're still scratching the surface, but we're going a little deeper in. So let's talk now, let's pull back away from the science and talk about the art side of things. When you want to design a character, a set, a map, a room, a whatever, figure the first thing you want to do is, what are you trying to make the player feel and experience? And use that as your primary color base. Now, I'm not talking if it's red. It has to be a bright apple red like Teal's hair. It doesn't have to be a deep red like blood. But if red's your primary color, find the red that works, that fits that feeling. Then build your color palette around that color, whether it be triadic, square, tetrachromatic. Thank you. Regardless, then you will have your color scheme, and that's how you build your character costume, etc. The problem, yes, blood for the blood god. The problem that a lot of designers do is that they just kind of put whatever. I'm not talking about like real artists. I'm talking about people who have no experience in color theory. They say, oh, this character looks good with this. This character looks good with this. And maybe subconsciously you're filling in the gaps, but maybe you're not. Maybe you're actually underplaying your character. There was a one where somebody had posted a picture a year or so ago to one of the art channels on the Studio Blue server. Does my character look better with this color hair, this color hair, this color hair? And a lot of people were saying, oh, this, or this. And I asked the artist, why? No, not why, but what do you want this character to be? Oh, this character is this and this. This character looks good with that color hair. That kind of thing. You know, thinking in my head, what am I looking at? Am I looking at a ranger? Am I looking at a wizard? Am I looking at a thief? What am I looking at now in my head? What colors does my brain want to see?
Right.
And that's what we do with everything. That's what we did with the Rosenheart characters. If you look at Victoria and Naomi, what are we trying to do? Victoria has those very light colors, those light blues, you know, for knowledge, the light whites, you know, the silvers. Look at that character. This character is airy. She's intelligent. You know, she's a little naive, but she's a smarty pants.
And there's an element of coldness there, too.
A little bit of coldness. Then we go to her twin sister, Naomi. Naomi's very active. She's energetic. She's optimistic. Her colors are red and gold, you know, gold yellow. So, boom, active.
Mm-hmm. And warmth.
It works. Yeah, the warmth. Those work. So look at every blonde character in a Japanese anime game versus a blonde in American media. Exactly. And it is cultural based, Kia. Absolutely. You look at a blonde in one society, you're going to look at a blonde differently in another. 100%.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Usagi Tsukino with her yellow ass hair and Sailor Moon. Little Miss Optimism herself. Amy Mizuno with her blue hair.
Yeah.
Super intelligent.
Super intelligent. Trustworthy. Loyal.
Mm-hmm. So you can use just a single thing and invoke that emotion. And then the rest of the costume you can build off of that color and have fun with it. So don't think that you have to have every smart character with blue hair.
Right.
But use blue somewhere. And the brain will fill in the gap. And that's what it's all about. I talked a few minutes ago about the science of the brain filling in gaps. That's everything the human brain does.
Right.
So you, as the artist, as the designer, as the developer, you want to have the player's brain fill in that gap. And you can use color to help do that.
Mm-hmm.
You can also use color to tell your story.
Yes.
And the inclusion of colors or the exclusion of colors say something. If characters finally reach the promised land and they walk in and there's a distinctive lack of green, you've just changed the narrative of your story.
Yeah, you have.
Why does the promised land not have any green? Why is Mako Mako Lifestream green in Final Fantasy?
Yeah.
Think about that. INT, reason, intelligence, wisdom, intuition, and willpower. Yeah, exactly right, Thane.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Do you have anything to add, Teal? And by the way, guys, if you have questions, please throw them out.
Yeah,
we got
please.
Maybe about at least 10 more minutes on this. We got this. What do you have on your end, hon?
Well, I just wanted to say that use color to unite all your different elements in your game.
Yes.
Your maps to your UI,
uh-huh.
to your game's theme,
yep.
to your music, everything.
Yep.
Because, yes, music also evokes color.
It does.
So use color to unite all those different elements in your game.
Mm-hmm.
You will create harmony, and your players will have a much more pleasant experience in playing your game. And that's what it's all about, is maximizing the player experience.
Yes. What has become what has become collectively known as the UX, the user experience.
Mm-hmm.
Chaos Dreamer brings up a great, great point. Or like Avatar the Last Airbender. Absolutely. Color was used exactly to tell stories.
We have a troll,
thing. Yep.
A spam thing.
We do.
Okay. The Last Airbender. Mm-hmm.
Yep, The Last Airbender. And I'm going to go ahead and get rid of that. But yeah, The Last Airbender is absolutely true. We don't seem to have a lot of blue food. Blue does not occur naturally in nature like
it is. No, it is not. And that's why we don't see blue in too many foods.
Yeah.
It's not edible in nature.
Yes.
Fungus is blue. You have blue fungus.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of your poison things are blue. But honestly, blue is not a color you find naturally.
Yep.
In flora.
Blueberries, yes. Everyone mentions blueberries.
But then again, blueberries are not truly blue.
They're not. They're not. They're purple.
Mm-hmm.
Blue milk. Blueberries are really dark red. Thank you, Gryphon.
Yes, they are.
They are. Like a dark red wine almost. Yeah. But you're right. They are. But they're not actually blue. In fact, just to show this, I actually used blue food coloring in a dish I made a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
And it looked utterly inedible. It tasted fantastic.
Awful. It looked terrible.
But it looked awful because we as a species don't look at blue as edible.
Right.
Another interesting thing about blue, before we get to a human's question, it's also one of the last colors humankind could see.
Yeah.
For a very long time, early humans, did not see the color blue.
They just couldn't perceive it.
Right. They couldn't perceive it. Right. I shouldn't say they couldn't see it. We can see it.
They can see it. They couldn't perceive it. They didn't know it was blue.
Right. So, interestingly enough, that's hilarious, right, Thane? And it distracted me. Interestingly enough, the sky was not blue to them for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Because they didn't understand it.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, they didn't understand what they were looking at, so it would be a gray. It would be like a just a color. It would just be like a grayish. I don't know how a color would look like when you can't perceive it.
Yeah.
So I'm assuming it would be a gray. That's actually a good anthropology question.
It is, or I think it was Homer's Odyssey. He talked about the wine dark sea.
Yeah. So maybe a purple.
I have no idea.
If anyone in chat knows that, that's a very good question. But yes, no, blue was the last color we developed the ability to see. It is crazy. Life is crazy.
Boo Boo Hotep, I don't know if you're making a joke about blue milk, but that is an expression used blue milk to describe freshly pumped milk.
Right.
From the cow. It's freshly. Blue milk.
Right from the teat.
Mm-hmm.
Literally. Yes.
It's called blue milk.
It's called blue milk. That's probably the case. That's actually a good question that we can look up online and get back with everyone on AMA Friday. Like, because you guys ask amazing questions and we don't always have the answers. But yes, let's go to what Human says.
Okay.
Human says, not sure if I mentioned this. Any particular good examples in games, movies of great color usage or really bad ones?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Let's go with a couple. First off, I'll mention it again. The girl in the red dress in Schindler's List. One of the most impactful scenes in the movie is Oskar Schindler watching the destruction of the ghetto at Warschau, and he sees a little girl in a red dress, and it's the only color in an otherwise black or white movie. He sees the girl, red dress, her body, in a pile that's being brought to, you know, just a bonfire several scenes later, i.e. she doesn't make it.
Yeah.
So for the first scene, he sees her trying to get through and hiding, and you hope she survives, and then later he sees she didn't survive, and that's what clicks, and he becomes the savior of the story that he becomes. That's a brilliant use of color. Another brilliant use of color is Gladiator.
Ooh, an
amazing movie. Here's the reason why the movie's color is so good. Everything in Rome, alive, non-Elysian feels, has a blue filter over it. That blue filter creates a feeling of coldness, that detachment. Life can end at any moment. The world is cruel. Commodus is a horrible person. He has a wife and child raped and murdered. He is pure evil, and this gladiator's life can end at any moment. When it goes to the Elysium scenes during the flashbacks and at the end, it's a warmer, slightly gold sepia tone. There's more gold than sepia. Warmth, comfort. This is reality. This is real. He's with his wife and child again. Beautifully done. The use of color in Sin City. Fantastic the way it's a black and white film, but blood is highly contrasted white. And the yellow bastard, as we talked about, is yellow to show sickness. That's really good. The 300, the original 300, where they sucked up that saturation, just pulled it up. They pulled up that saturation of certain colors to pop out the insanity of war. Wes Anderson, that's another good example. Now, color's done really badly. Anything from Tromaville? Although it's my guilty pleasure. I love Toxic Avenger.
Yeah.
A lot of the old schlocky horror movies did not do blood well at all. Look at all the old horror movies and look at how they did blood. It is really bad. That's a really good example of not using color right.
Mm-hmm.
Because the blood looks so fake in so many old school horror films. Old Chinese and Japanese actually call blue is green. There you go, Reverie. Thank you. Thank you for that heads up there.
Here's a example. First of all, I wanted to say that also in Sin City, the color red is used, the blonde in the red dress.
The woman in the red dress at the beginning. Yep.
Yeah. So there's, you know, just that pop of color.
Yeah.
Please, movies that use color badly.
Hey, let's, Cloud, welcome to the stream. Yeah, go ahead, Teal.
Let's talk about Disney Dark Age. Okay. The Sword in the Stone and the Aristocats and... I don't know, Black Cauldron, all that stuff. Color is used terribly in those.
Yes.
It is an atrocious what they did for the color in those movies. The color is muddy. They use all the wrong types of colors for their interiors. It's actually rather badly done. Go back and take a look at those movies with a critical eye. Especially The Sword in the Stone.
In particularly, yes.
That is an egregious use of color and lighting. Very bad. The colors look muddy. And in some instances, they choose the wrong color for the object or the person's clothing. Terrible.
Randomly making everything that Mad Madam Mim turns into in sort of a pink-purple.
Yeah.
It's like, what was the reason for that? Is it because it's not even the opposite of Merlin's blue? It was just, yes, chaos. The Dark Ages movies are nostalgic, beautiful. I love the Aristocats. I love the Sword in the Stone. I love the Black Cauldron. But I can love a movie and still say, art on an art level, it didn't do very well. And on an art level, a lot of those movies did not do well. What to have. Thank you, Ryth. That's the brightest line in the movie. That and like whenever Archimedes starts cracking up.
Yeah.
those movies are fantastic, but you got to look at it from the art standpoint, not from the nostalgia of, hey, this was Disney.
No, please look at them with a critical eye.
Yes. Which is what Studio Blue does. We critique everything. We critique our own critiques. Reverie says this, speaking of blood, oh, Rythe mentions Neo from the Matrix like the chick in the red dress. Yeah, red dress is often sensuality and seduction.
Right.
Reverie has a very good question. Speaking of blood, what do you think of Danganronpa using bright pink for blood? I think it's brilliant.
It is brilliant.
It is. Because you know what it is. It's bright pink, so it pops. But what it also does, and people are like, oh, they're doing it to get through the sensors. No, what they're doing it is to draw attention to it. It's too horrible to realize. These characters, Makoto and the rest of them, are kids. They're teenagers. I don't care how they're drawn. They are all teenagers. They're in a terrible situation where they are literally being tortured daily by Monokuma.
Right.
Psychologically. And some of them are being physically, you know, brutally executed. So the bright pink for the blood is the brain going into overdrive and hyper-seeing the blood.
Yeah.
That's what I pull from it from an artistic standpoint. Does it help get past the censors? Yes, that's how Sin City had its rating. Sin City is exceptionally gory, but by having the blood be like bright white and yellow and stuff, it pulls that away a little bit. So that detachment helps you deal with it. It helps get past the censors and it pops.
Yeah.
It's several layers of psychology at once for both Danganronpa and Sin City that work.
Yeah.
Let's talk about some games with good color palettes. Let's talk about some games now, outside of Danganronpa, because we just mentioned it. So, games with good or bad color palettes. Good uses of color or bad uses of color. Do you want to go first? Do you want me to?
Sure. Fallout.
Oh, yeah.
Has a good color palette and a good use of color to further their narrative of a civilization that's been destroyed. The desolation, the hopelessness.
Right.
They use a good balance of, they have a monochromatic color schemes, and they also use some triadic schemes in their settlements.
They do.
And, you know, honestly, what we talked about, the lack of green earlier, denotes a lack of life.
Right.
The sky itself, you only really see a blue sky when you get out to Sanctuary.
Right.
The furthest away from everything.
Mm-hmm.
It's the furthest away from the glowing sea. It's the furthest away from Boston. It's the only place that has a truly blue sky. Everywhere else, the sky is muted. It's either gray or it's a greenish color.
I agree also with what Chaos just said, the Elder Scrolls. Actually, Bethesda on a whole has a very good grasp of color. Skyrim is not as well done as Oblivion.
No, it's not.
Oblivion uses color like a boss. It is still visually, I'm not talking about graphic quality, I'm talking about
visually,
colors.
Yeah.
It is their best game. Visually.
Mm-hmm.
It even beats, in my opinion, The Elder Scrolls Online, which utilizes all the provinces and therefore has tons of different chances to use color. But Oblivion is god tier with its color usage.
Mm-hmm.
Skyrim is not as good. They tried too hard to make it look like a cold north that happened to have trees.
Yeah.
And it doesn't work. Now, with mods, you can make The Elder Scrolls look unbelievable. Like, my modded Skyrim is, oh my god. But that's someone else fixing the developer's problem.
Mm-hmm.
For me, a fantastic game with it. Well, there you go, right? And it was outsourced. It wasn't even them. So, my favorite game for color. And this is funny, too, because we're actually mentioning games we're going to go over in our graphical theme workshop, which is going to be a few weeks from now. Persona 5. Persona 5 uses color unbelievably. I'm not going to go too deep into it because I actually have a wonderful dissertation planned for it. But the way that they pop their colors using red, white, and black, I have never seen a game do that. Another great game with amazing colors is the one we're playing on Thursday night, Final Fantasy VII Remake. It is unbelievable how they're able to juxtapose the cold grayness of Midgar, the sick green of the sewers like Don Corneo's sewer, the green life of Aerith's garden around Elmira's house, the color of the materia that has like the life energy of the planet, Scarlet's red dress.
Oh, yes.
Unbelievable. Yes, Nier Automata. Great use of color.
Because Nier Automata is a very good example of a game that gets it right.
From start to finish.
Yeah.
Like, the coldness is gray tones, and they use a lot of that tone, adding in the gray.
And the color temperature.
Right, and it's cold. And then you'll have these little areas where it's warm. And those are the areas like Pascal's Village,
mm-hmm.
you know, certain parts of the amusement park. But those warmths generate a feeling, and it's usually in sync with 2B having a moment where her humanity comes forward. And then you juxtapose that to 9S's story, minor spoilers, and you start seeing his madness set in.
Mm-hmm.
Both 2B and 9S have similar character journeys, but they end up at two separate points. And they're both using color to tell that part of the story. Very well done.
Yes, it is.
Now, doing it badly, games that don't do color well. Any on your end?
Games that don't do color well.
Yeah.
You know, generally, I put those down.
Well, I have one. Go ahead. It's exceedingly popular. And it's, I don't know if it's one of the more recent ones because I haven't played one since the Wii.
Mm-hmm.
I have a problem with most of Super Mario Brothers games' palettes.
Yes! Too, oh my god!
Too hyper-saturated. Yeah. I know they're trying to be cartoony, but the further I get away, the further we go into it, like, you know, Super Mario Galaxy, Galaxy 2, I haven't played Odyssey, but the saturation for me in Mario games are up way too high now.
Oh yeah.
They're exceedingly popular. I'm not going to take away from it. But I actually get more annoyed nowadays playing a Mario game than I used to back during the times of, like, Super Mario Brothers 1, 2, 3.
Because you were younger then.
Yeah.
Yeah, that Mario is targeted towards kids, teenagers.
It is.
That's their target audience, so the colors are just loud and bright, and it's annoying.
Right. So, I'm not going to say the developers failed, because I believe that's their intention. But it puts me out as a target audience.
Yeah.
Also, since I see a lot of colors, to me it is an overload.
Yep.
Any that you can remember that they just didn't do the colors right. I haven't played Breath of the Wild, Boba Hotep. Neither one of us have.
It's been a while, but I'm gonna have to say, as much as I hate to, Parasite Eve.
Oh, Parasite Eve's colors.
They got the colors. They're badly done.
Yeah.
The use of color in their set design was almost non-existent.
Do you feel they tried too hard to ramp up the horror end of what was basically a sci-fi thriller?
Yes. Yes, they did.
I kind of get that feeling, too. They tried too hard to put a horror color scheme onto a non-horror game.
The colors just... It came out rather jarring because you're like... You know, you're going through a sewer and all of a sudden you encounter this brightly colored something or other.
Right.
And you just... It just jars you. It jars you out of the experience. Right.
They did a good job of fixing that for the second game, which they changed the control scheme, so that killed all the old players being able to play in it. But you're right. The first one, it's a too stark of a contrast.
Yes, it is. A too many contrasts.
I can see that.
Mm-hmm.
So that hopefully that answers your question, human. If anyone else has any questions, please go ahead and toss them out there. But a lot of times, badly done coloration is either a purposeful design scheme where they want to target, for example, children as their audience, bright colors everywhere, bright colors, high saturation, or the developer just doesn't understand how color works. It's rare that you're going to see a color be used consciously in a negative way.
Yes.
Because most people don't want to obviously scare away their audiences. And a good example of throwing high levels of color in a positive way is Wii U, Splatoon. The one where you're basically trying to outpaint everybody.
Oh, yeah.
And that's using a certain pastel.
Mm-hmm.
So it's pastels of, you know, it's lighter tints of blue and green and pink. That does it really well. It doesn't, I mean, yeah, it's color everywhere and it's madness, but it's not in a way where you're oversaturated. You know, you're going to get your daily dose of color in Splatoon, but you're not going to get blinded by color. Bubba Hotep says, I'm okay with all the colors in Breath of the Wild, but the green they use for the grass is really bright. Well, I don't know why they did that. Maybe you actually have four cones. Who knows? Take the test.
Oh, I just thought of a game.
All right, go for it.
And it's not the entire game.
Okay.
But it's one of the maps in the game.
Mm-hmm.
And that's in Sims 4.
Okay.
Where you crawl through a tree and discover this alternate realm. It's a fairy realm.
Oh, no.
And, oh, God, the colors are ghastly. Yes. It's ghastly what they use.
Yes.
The wrong shade of purple. With paints and
uh-huh.
and just muddy teals, it's terrible. It makes me cringe every really time is. I go there. Mm-hmm. I'm just cringing.
I remember you showing that to me and me going, "That's a lot of color." That's one of the reasons why people who do VR games really have to watch their color, because unlike in a regular game where it's on a screen, a 2D game, I should call it. Where you're playing it and you're playing on a flat surface, whether it be a 3D engine or a 2D engine is irrelevant. You can look away. You have things around you, a frame that you can use to ground yourself. When I'm playing a virtual reality game, if the colors are really badly done, I will not play that game. There's a fantastic game out for the VR helmets called Job Simulator. And it's a lot of fun because you're basically just, you're in a robot museum way in the future. And, oh, these are how people used to do, you know, fast food and stuff. And on its surface, it's a hilarious game. I can only play it for a short period of time because the color saturation's up real high.
Oh.
Same thing with the Rick and Morty sandbox in VR. The saturation's a little too high for me. So, okay, it's annoying. But then I play a game like Skyrim VR or Half-Life Alyx.
Mm-hmm.
And you can tell they know exactly what they're doing. Quick heads up, if you have a VR headset and you haven't bought Half-Life Alyx, buy it. Not only is the game amazing, but Valve proves they still know what they're doing. And one of the things they know what they're doing is their color palette choice. Yeah, it's weird, right? Exactly, Padre. It's like you take it off and you're like, the world's not supposed to look like that. I laughed my ass off at the fast food one where they bring in robot Gordon Ramsay, who's really nice to you until the camera turns on, then he yells at you for 5 minutes, they turn it off. So the game is great, but as soon as I take it off, I'm like, that's not how the world looks.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Anyway, any other questions about any of this? I will be posting the link to the test after this is over with on our Discord. If you're not a member of our Discord, please join us, our online community.
You might want to also post it in the description.
I will.
You know, the video.
I will. If I can remember. I will. But yes, if you're not a member of our Discord community, please consider joining. We are a critique server, meaning that if you are a budding writer, game developer, artist, etc., you can post your work there and people will critique it. It is a blanket understanding that if you post something on our server, it will be critiqued because we are a feedback server. But we also hang out from time to time. We had a great conversation earlier today. But hopefully that has been helpful. If you have any other questions, please throw them out. Teal, anything else on your end?
No, that's it.
All right. So this is our last chance to toss out a question. We've been doing this for an hour and 15. That's fantastic. Let me see if Hawk is running tonight. Nope, Hawk is not running. So when we end, we will end. But if anyone has any last minute questions, or toss them out now. If you have any comments, if you're watching this on VOD, please hit it up on the comment section. If you wish to continue this conversation on our Discord channel, we encourage that. For all of you who are new to this, we do our creator classrooms every Monday where we tackle a topic related to either game design or writing or any other similar creative process. We choose our topics generally the day of, so please don't look for a schedule because things can change at a moment's notice, unfortunately.
Yeah.
On Wednesdays and Thursdays, we have what we call our critical play, where we play a AAA title and we offer critical feedback on the game in hopes that it helps budding developers learn how to improve their craft. We're currently playing Dragon Quest XI on Wednesday with my wife Teal as the player, and Thursday with me playing Final Fantasy VII Remake, which we should be ending this week, by the way, get the word out. And then Fridays is our AMA Ask Us Everything, where we just ask us anything. We just sit around, drink an adult beverage, and chit-chat. Did this help you guys? That's my last thing before I hit the button to kind of close it out. Was this helpful? This is an extremely complex topic. Like Teal said in the beginning, we are scratching the surface of what is this basically going to be a deep dive for you.
Right.
So did this kind of primer help? because if it did, then we can use this as a foothold for the rest of our graphical series. For everyone else, hopefully you're able to draw something positive away from it. I'm gonna take a second and drink some water, and then we'll hit the outro.
Okay.
All right. Any last minute words on your end, Teal?
No, just keep on plugging away, keep on learning, keep on diving.
Okay. Last two questions. Actually, Gryphon makes a comment, need more info. That is something we should probably post at some point, is do you want us to go deeper into color theory? Because we could easily make a long-term series out of this. We highly, highly recommend start taking a Udemy course. Maybe we could make one. Studio Blue's Udemy course on color theory.
Oh, gosh.
Hey, it only costs $19. So, okay. So here we go. Chaos Dreamer asks, what's the hardest question in the color gaming?
What?
Not sure what that means. I'm not 100% sure what you're asking there, Chaos, but let's just say that you're asking, what is the hardest thing to answer about gaming and color? The hardest question a game developer will ever ask themselves in regards to color is, what is my palette? What is my game's palette? That right there, what is my graphical color theme? And we actually have an upcoming workshop specifically on choosing your graphical theme.
Yes.
So, Chaos, if that's what you're asking, the hardest question you will ever ask yourself is, what's my graphical theme? Thank you very much, Reverie. Thank you so much, Sarsla.
Thank you.
Awesome, Chaos. Thank you for joining us. Hope you'll meet us in the future. Let's go ahead and call it tonight.
Okay.
So we've enjoyed this. We hopefully have given you guys a plethora, that's a word, of information. We hope that every single one of you will join us in upcoming creator classrooms and join us in Critical Plays Wednesday and Thursday. We continue to do this because we want each and every one of you to be the absolute best you can be. Isn't that right, honey?
That's right.
So we love each and every one of you, and we want to thank you for being here. And as we like to say, if you like what you saw, leave a smack down the like button below, subscribe to our channel, consider supporting us on Patreon, connect with us over Facebook, Twitter, Discord, and we'll see you in the next video.
See you next time.
Say you like that. If I hate you, then find someone.